Dr. Zielinski, thank you so much for joining us.
Well, thank you, Rudy, for having me.
So that's what singing your praises sounds like in Farsi. you're quite a rock star in my estimation. I want to say thank you. I know you're extremely busy. You're traveling all over. And I really appreciate you taking time out of your Sunday to tell us more about this fascinating, groundbreaking work that you guys are doing at the Mind Eye Institute, which you founded yourself. So let's try to simplify it because it's quite complicated. I listened to a very three-part lecture you had twice, actually, and I'm a bio major from UCLA, but it's still very complicated. And yet it's not. You've been devoting your past 30 years to this optometric rehabilitation, right? And
yes.
It's the fancy way of saying it is development of advanced methods for assessing brain function with an emphasis on often untested linkages between the eye and ears. Help us understand what all this means.
Well, basically it means that if you take your brain and you have your fist and pull a chunk of brain tissue forward, that becomes your retina, which is the lining of your eye.
Mm-hmm.
So one of the things that people need to know is that the retina itself, the inside of the eye, is an actual piece of your brain. It's not connected to your brain. It is your brain.
It is your brain. And so, from those retinas, you're getting inputs from, what, 126 million neurons, I think you said, from each eyeball?
It's 126 million receptors. There's actually only, and then they're down all those signals into 1.2 million neurons.
So just 1.2 million. Go ahead.
But the 1.2 million of them, the signals, a good chunk of them, 90%, is from what you're putting your attention on for details. But the other couple hundred thousand neurons are providing information about your surroundings, and that's what's left off in a regular eye exam.
And
so if you're looking at a target, then you might, let's say, be watching television in front of you, but out of the corners of your eyes, you're seeing the room around you, the ceiling, the floor, people moving, and that peripheral awareness is critical. And what we're testing in a regular eye exam is the central attention.
I see. So how do you test that?
Well, the typical test for 20/20 is where you cover up one eye, and then you put an instrument in front of the other eye to block off the periphery, and you look through a little hole at a non-moved chart. That's the typical test. But to test the periphery, and then to link the peripheral awareness with the central attention, we have a whole bunch of patented tests for mind-eye assessments. And we're testing visual localization, auditory localization, well, somebody can judge where a target is instead of just what it is.
So basically how they're processing this information. Am I understanding correctly?
How they're processing where an object is, because if you don't know where it is, then you can't aim accurately at it. And if you're not aiming accurately, you can't focus on it, and then it's not clear. So you get a lot of people who claim they can't see and things are blurry, but it's not because they're nearsighted. It's because they don't aim properly.
Very interesting. Now, what happens when, how do you figure out that these systems are off? My understanding is that sometimes people have problems where their auditory is not working properly with their visual, correct?
That's totally correct.
And then
in autism, that's a big problem.
And so that messes up the mind. I mean, I can imagine that if you're born with a problem where your hearing isn't connecting to your visual, you and your research say the brain chooses to shut down, correct?
Well, the brain chooses either auditory or visual, or it switches back and forth really fast, but you don't get the social cues that everybody else because just for plain social cues, you have to use two parts of your eye to get body language from the periphery and facial expressions from the center. And then you have to use two parts of your ears to get tone of voice and content of words. And then you have a right side and a left side. So there's, you know, two eye parts on the right, two eye parts on the left, two ears on the right, two ears on the left. There's eight different sensory inputs just for social cues. And if they're out of sync with each other, then people just break down and say, I'm not going to deal with the environment. I'll just listen to the words, but I won't listen to the tone, or I won't care about body language. I'll just, you know, watch their facial expressions, or I'll just tune everything out and be in my own little world and daydream.
Mm-hmm. And that's that also defines autism, correct? That puts them on an autistic spectrum.
That's right. Vanderbilt University did a study a couple years ago and found that of autistic children, their eyes and ears were out of sync. But what they didn't realize is you can put glasses on and get back in sync.
Right. So how?
That's what we do.
And that's incredible. I mean, the success stories are incredible. I'm not saying you can help every autistic child, but you've helped so many. And you've made a nonverbal autistic child be able to communicate. So how does that work with a pair of glasses?
Well, because we're altering brain function. We're not using 20/20 as an endpoint. We're using sensory balancing as an endpoint and comfort. So with that particular autistic child who was nonverbal, his ears worked. He could hear, but they didn't work with his eyes. And what he wrote after he got glasses is that when he went to a restaurant, all of a sudden he could hear people in separate conversations. And previously, without the glasses, he said it sounded like a wind tunnel where there was just a lot of noise. So if he used his eyes to look at things, his ears kind of shut down and were sending confusing information.
That's
and if he used his eyes weren't seeing properly.
And so these special made glasses, basically helped him be able to filter the information, process it better. So it makes so much sense. It makes so much sense what you're saying, that, you know, we've got to explore what else is going on in the eye, which is sending so much information to the brain. So why are we still using the same eye test they used in the 19th century? Why is the optometry world so far behind? Why isn't this makes so much sense. Why isn't this mainstream?
Well, because when I discovered it, it was the early 90s, and there wasn't any research on eye-ear connections. And I was told that, you know, it's a fluke. And I said, but I've got people in different countries working on this. It can't be a fluke over thousands of people for decades. And eventually in the late, 2010, 2012, 2014, then some research started coming out showing that the eyes and ears are connected. So it has only been since about 2016, 2017, where there's been heavy-duty research proving that eyes and ears are connected. And so it hasn't had enough time to get from the research to the doctors and then into the schools and get retaught. So Mind Eye Institute is, we're trying to bridge the gap between the neuroscience research and the public. Mm-hmm. We're in the midst of trying to onboard other doctors so that we could help people. We see international people here every week. We have people flying in from many different countries. And eventually we want to be training doctors all around the world to help people.
What would you say your success rate is? Let's say you have 10 patients. How many are you able to help? I know this is a random, but it's just, I'm just trying to understand how powerful this is.
If they're compliant, we're probably helping 9 out of 10 do something. Now, when you say help, you don't mean taking somebody who's not neurotypical and then all of a sudden making them neurotypical.
No.
But when we have a lot of brain injury patients, and there's probably over 80% of them have reductions in their symptoms from the brain injuries. My goal in the long run is to be like Jonas Salk and wipe out dyslexia. Mm-hmm. That would be my legacy, but hopefully that will be in the next several decades.
Well, I think you don't have to worry about your legacy. You're going to have a huge, I can't even believe you haven't won the Nobel Prize yet, but I'm calling it here on this show. You will win the Nobel Prize for your work. The biggest problem, like you said, is you don't have the ability to train people fast enough. And it's such a nuanced treatment. There's no exact science here, right?
Well, there is a science, but there's also an art component to it. There's a skill as well as the actual science. And that's the thing. During our training process for other tours, we're teaching them about brains, because that's the problem, that the eye doctors don't learn enough about brains and the brain doctors don't learn enough about eyes, thus the mind-eye connection. You know, our Mind-Eye Institute is doing a lot to teach the doctors brain function and how we're actually affecting it, and then posture is affecting it also. You know, we have people who shift their posture and their whole perception of the world is altered.
Well, I mean, that might be a case for me. I've been suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder, I'll say since Syria, but it could be even since the revolution in Iran when I was a child and many of my family members were killed. But just to understand, and I saw a video of a gentleman, a war veteran, I believe he was, who was, you had, just by putting on a pair of glasses, you had been able to help him deal with his PTSD. How does that work?
Well, his was fun because his was during sleep. He had nightmares, horrible nightmares, and he would be lashing out in the middle of the night. So he had come and said, you know, thank you for saving my marriage. I can sleep with my wife now because since he had the glasses, he was calmer when he was sleeping and not having the nightmares and not thrashing around. But how it works is something that in the next few years, hopefully the research at MindEye will get it definitively. But basically what we're doing is synchronizing all the sensory systems that are inputting the eyes and ears and the posture and other systems, and the patient's system then gets calmer. Mm-hmm. And if it's calmer, it produces fewer stress chemicals. Mm-hmm. So if your eyes and ears are out of sync, then your brain is going to be stressed. When you're stressed, you produce stress chemicals. The stress chemicals either hypersensitize your peripheral or they shut down your peripheral. That's the fight or flight or freeze type response.
And what are these glasses made of? What is in this? What is it made of? How does this work?
Well, glasses, the lenses just bend light.
Okay.
So the key is bending light to different spots on your retina, because each of the spots on your retina is a piece of your brain, and it leads to different brain circuitry. So currently, people use glasses to make things clear or blurry, which is the center part of your retina, and we're using glasses addressing the peripheral part. So a lot of people who have 20/20 eyesight and who are told they don't need any glasses, they do need glasses for them because the eye and the left eye are each 20/20, but working at different speeds or efficiencies. So they're not.
If somebody is having a problem in, let's say, has a concussion, they come to you, you test their eyes, you test their hearing, you do brain scans, and you connect the dots of what's not working properly?
Oh, not exactly. What we do is test the many, many visual skills that aren't tested in a regular exam. I mean, there's many visual skills. For instance, peripheral awareness, reaction time, planning, where to move. There's seven different sets of perceptual skills, you know, how to scan. So we test a lot of different visual processing skills. And based on those, we try to figure out how a person's brain works. We look at who they are as a person, what interests them, and then prescribe accordingly. You have comfort ranges and tolerance ranges, and people you can push into a tolerance range, and they like the challenge, and other people in comfort mode. So we prescribe according to who the person is. It's a unique prescription.
Well, it's fascinating to me. I would like to come and be seen by you myself for my nervous problem, and I'll discuss it extensively in another show, actually. But if people are interested in coming to Chicago to see you, how would they go about doing this?
The easiest way is to go to our website. It's just mindeye.com. So MINDEYE.com.
Uh-huh. And they can just schedule an appointment and come in. Are you guys backed up? How does it work? Is it hard to get an appointment with you?
Well, they'd be talking to a new patient advocate, mm-hmm. and we would get an assessment of where they're at, what their problem is, mm-hmm. so that we could figure out the best doctor for them to see, and then the best testing to do. So, because we have to adequately block the amount of time off. So yeah. If a nonverbal patient, that's different than a verbal one. If you have perceptual problems, So we have symptoms and analyze and figure out the best scheduling. As far as whether we're booked up or not, you know, we're currently training more and more doctors. So
I've never wanted to be an optometrist more in my life, honestly. This is groundbreaking. This is fascinating. What made you think about this, Dr. Zielinski? I mean, so many doctors before you obviously never thought of this.
I was goofing around with one of my friends and she was saying how good her ears were, and I said, prove it. So I thought I'll put distorting glasses on her, and I was going to laugh at her because the distortion made her see the target farther in a different place, but she mistakenly closed her eyes. And then I discovered that with her eyes closed, the glasses still had an effect on where she heard the sounds. And so I took that discovery and then started honing it with different patients, and then eventually found that ADD children were hypersensitive to that effect, and worked on with patients saying, you know, which is better, one or two, and they would say, I don't know, they're about. So I would use my Z-Bell test, and one of the, you know, choice number one, they'd find my bell, and choice number two, they couldn't. So I would say, well, since you don't see a difference, I'll just put the one where the bell works. And people started coming back saying, wow, these are the most comfortable pair of glasses.
Brilliant. So brilliant. I know we haven't heard the last of this, and I'm hoping to have you back on the show when there's more news to share. And I really appreciate you being with us, Dr. Zielinski. Thank you so much.
So thank you, Rudy.